we had about 100 dogs started barking. Now, there's not even 100 dogs. There's not even 15 dogs in the neighborhood, but it was 100 dogs started barking. You see what I'm saying? Just barking, going crazy. Now, those were called the Hounds of Hell, or the Anubis Realm. And that whole hundred, that realm, the Hounds of Hell, is a whole set chapter in Robert Temple's book, The Serious Mystery, on the Hounds of Hell. You can see the Hounds of Hell in their vicious form on the show Supernatural. They'll show up every now and then. So these dogs came from another dimension, and they were barking. And they barked, and then the next day, they disappeared. We didn't hear it anymore. Never heard it again. But we heard and continue to hear, and this is where the mystery is broken. We heard and continue to hear one hound dog that was not in the neighborhood before that night that all the other people started barking. We never heard this dog before. But this dog was left behind, and this is indicating that whatever that gateway, that Hounds of Hell gateway that was open, never closed. And the one dog is there to indicate these things. You see what I'm saying? Then you can understand why you could get blanketed all over the East Coast. You see what I'm saying? With this whole thing with this snow and stuff. And then you could also, it might be a ritual when Barack Obama made the announcement that they should give Mike Vick for the dog. Yeah, you see, now they all up in arms and stuff. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
One of the senators said he should have got the death penalty for killing dogs. Well,
yes.
You know what it is. They feel more about their dogs than they do these Negroes. But anyway.
True.
But it's very interesting. But it indicated a gateway. And right after that, we started missing time, missing day. Where did the day go? Where did it go? I'm not talking about like it looked up and it was 1 hour and the next thing it was late. No, we missed a whole day, you know, thinking it's Wednesday when it's Thursday. So we talk about these dimensions that are open and never close. You see what I'm saying? So this is very interesting stuff on how certain things is going on. Now, we do remember now that the UN came out against UFOs. The UN in October. And then Stephen Hawking came out and said that the UFOs are might be hostile.
Mm-hmm.
Now, both on Supernatural and on True Blood, the two shows, they indicated that the UFOs was the fairy realm, which is called the Fae. That realm, and they indicated that, and so, which goes back to when we get on into this particular lecture, we will make that connection on what they're talking about and what is this UFO thing and how this thing is related to this particular solstice and stuff that's going on. You see, so we're gonna have Gabby give a big shout out to Sister Tina Marie for making the transition. And it's interesting here because, you know, Michael Jackson made the 25th, James Brown the 25th, Eartha Kitt the next year the 25th, and she did it on the 26th. But come to find out, her daughter had a birthday party, and she gave the daughter, I think she had just turned 18, she gave her a birthday party on Christmas, and then the daughter found her in the bed, you know, made the transition on the next day. But she had already had a seizure about a month before. So, but you know, like I say, these days, this is good to get a vacation from this hellhole. You see what I'm saying? So we're going to give a shout-out to her.
Yeah.
You see. Now, it's interesting here because another thing that also went down and was the arrival of the Yoruba god Oshosi. And it was interesting here because the Witch's Almanac, they have one every year. The Witch's Almanac came out. So the one for 2010 had a whole article on Oshosi. And so The brother Andrew Brown, the brother out in Chicago, you know, I had to send him the article and all because he had been doing work with Oshosi. And there were interesting things. And so during the time of when I was going to Alabama, I read some information on Oshosi coming from a book by the name of The Way of the Orishas. And it's very interesting about Oshosi, which is indicated in that book, and it's indicated in the legends of Bobble Isles and different things, and that is this. And this is going to turn into a major deity. Now, Oshosi is the god of the hunt. He's a hunter. So he would be represented with the bow and arrow. They also connect him to a Sagittarian deity. They also connected him to Rama. Rama in the who is the god of with the bow and arrow, whose partner is Hanuman, who builds a bridge to the other world to rescue Lakshmi, who was stolen by a demon. And the monkey god and his fellow monkeys build a bridge to the other realm. And that bridge also is connected to DNA. Your DNA building itself to another realm to receive the goddess Lakshmi, which is forms of Isis. And the goddess Lakshmi, her name is Sita, though. Vishnu incarnates several incarnations, and Lakshmi incarnates with him. So Vishnu incarnated as Rama, Lakshmi incarnated as Sita. Nevertheless, Vishnu and Lakshmi is Rama and Sita, as well as Vishnu incarnates as Krishna, and Lakshmi incarnates as Radha, in the different incarnations. Well, in this particular one, she incarnates as Sita, which is a form of Lakshmi, and Vishnu incarnates as Rama. Rama is the god with the bow and arrow, and his partner is Hanuman, and whoever has Hanuman on his side, you see what I'm saying, can't lose. And Hanuman then proceeds to build a bridge into the realm of the demons, of the Damians, to retrieve Sita, who was stolen from Rama. And so that bridge is also DNA. It also has something to do with DNA. The monkey is the primate, and is the ape of Thoth, or Tahuti, which is talking about melanin, magic, alchemy. The demons of the Damianic force is the dark substance of untapped melanin. You see, so all this stuff is alchemical story. Nevertheless, the Yoruba or West African version of that arrow-wielding hunter is Oshosi. Now, Oshosi, very key, because this is directly linked to us. If you go to Africa today, there's very few people know of Oshosi in Africa as they do in the New World, although he was a primordial African deity. And what had happened was the areas or the villages and the areas where Oshosi was venerated and worshipped in those particular realms, in those particular lands, in Nigeria, in that particular case, it would be Dahomey, Benin, what have you. The place where he was worshipped, the settlement where he was worshipped, they took so many slaves out of that area to the New World until his entire cult died out, because there was very little people who was left behind, so little that was left behind until eventually a lot of people didn't even know who Oshosi was, but he strived in America. Now, this is one of the keys. Number one, his avatar, his hierarchy, is the god Ovatala, which is the god of white or light. So we're going to let's check this out.
Okay.
There's a story of Oshosi being a great hunter. And I'll give you the short version of it. The story goes that he was hunting, and he hunted some pheasants. He hunted some pheasants. And he took them home and dropped them off. Then he left back out to go tend to some other business. His mother, who takes care of him in the aspect that she'll come through and she'll clean up his apartment or his home and different things like that, she saw the pheasants, and she took the pheasants home to cook them for him so he could have dinner later. So when he came home and saw the pheasants gone, this is the short version of it, because the long version, she took one pheasant, but in the short version, he took two pheasants. But in the long version, Arumalai was with him, and Arumalai is the oracle. So Arumalai could have told him that his mother did it, but Arumalai said, no, it looked like somebody stole it, just like you suspected. So apparently, whatever this deed was supposed to happen, because Arumalai could have told him, he was the oracle. He could have said, no, your mother took him. But he said, no, yeah, you're right, somebody stole him. So as a result, Oshoshi got mad, and his arrow never misses his mark. So the arrow, he said, well, he shot the arrow in the air and said, whoever stole these or whoever has these particular pheasants, may this arrow make its mark and kill who stole them. So as a result, the arrow went to his mother's house and killed his mother. And kill his mother. So this was the curse. Now, it's a hard story. Well, two aspects came out of this. The hero, they say, never can go home. He's on a journey, and home might have been an incubation part for him, but it is not where he's supposed to reside if he's supposed to make a journey to impact the world or to impact the spirit world. So you always have to leave the mother. You see what I'm saying? Right. Oh, the father has to die. You see what I'm saying? In this particular case, the mother died just like the father died with Horus, with Osiris. So now, but you know, Hamlet is also Horus. That Shakespeare is also Horus. And his mother dies with some treachery in Hamlet, which is nothing but Heru Horus. That's several books have indicated that was one of the stories. And Horus, as you know, is the precursor of Jesus. You know, so now anyway, so they could also say that he had to leave that particular nurturing behind. So you can say that's a part of the metaphor. But as the story went on, we find out that this is actually, because you have to read the mythology. The mythology can cover several areas of history, several epics of history. So what we have when the arrow killed his mother was not only a prophecy that he would lose the motherland in slavery, because no people in the motherland remembered him, but the people in the New World. You see what I'm saying? Because they stole so many slaves. So here in one thing, this story of his arrow killing his mother was actually a historical event that would occur thousands of years later, because we don't know how old these Yoruba myths are and these Egyptian myths, and they said that they existed simultaneously. Dr. Benningham said, you know, the Yoruba thing came out of Egypt, but no, we have two systems and two schools that existed simultaneously that go all the way back to Atlantis. We'll be talking about that on the 15th, on the 15th in New York. Now, but because so many slaves were taken, he lost his mother land, and in the myth, he kills his mother. You see what I'm saying? But the point about it is this, and it goes even deeper than that. Because Oshosi, we know, is a Yoruba version of a Christ figure. Now, this is the key on that particular Christ figure. The Christ figure that they're talking about is a whole group of people who went through the Middle Passage. Here go again, because we get locked on these one or two people, and then one real person steps into the seat and steps into the shoes, and next thing he's getting himself killed, or he's done killed 1,000 people and drank the damn Kool-Aid because somebody said they were the Christ. But one of the origins of what the secret societies say, a lot of Masonics, not Black Masons, you know, that's just a social club, drinking liquor and driving cab. We ain't talking about that. We talk about high up Masons. They say that the Christ